Good afternoon, Alistair.
Good afternoon, David. How are you?
I'm not too bad. So
not so bad, I'm bravely, people used to say. Well, you're not bravely yet. You know.
We're going to talk today, the theme that we've been given to talk about is the beginnings of bluegrass music and the Ulster Scots influence in North America.
Yeah, bluegrass and country, I suppose, yeah.
Yeah, it's one of those themes that, you know, we're often very good at talking up the links to the presidents and the big players, you know, like here in the Discover Ulster Scots Centre, we have a thing up, you know, with about the presidents, and we talk very proudly about the fact that I think it's 18 of the 45 have had Ulster Scots connections. But the smaller guy tends to be written out of the picture.
Yeah, and arguably, you know, country music and bluegrass music, bigger cultural impact on American and Western culture than any president ever had, and maybe in fact a more powerful force when you think about the modern world.
Yeah,
we can talk about that. There were very early guys, David, as you know, you had a man with the same name as your same surname as yourself, Henry Gilliland and Eck Robertson, two old guys who recorded very early on. In fact, they were heading to a Civil War reunion. Eck Robertson's going on behalf of his grandfather. They were Confederates. And Henry Gilliland had actually fought in the Civil War, so early in the 20th century. And they recorded a lot of stuff that had a big impact. And you had another old guy who sold a lot of records way before 1920, Fiddlin' John Carson, and had a sort of vaudeville stage act and everything. But I suppose what we call the big bang of country music happened in late July, early August 1927. And it happened, you know, in the Smoky Mountains, near the Clinch Mountain in the town of Bristol. Now, the interesting thing in terms of geography about Bristol is when you go there, there's a big line painted up the middle of Main Street. One side's Virginia and one side's Tennessee. And there's a Steve Earle song which talks about, you know, a shooting. He said, "I shot him in Virginia. He died in Tennessee." Presumably the guy stumbled, you know, across the road.
And but, you get the term there, when you're thinking back to the Bristol sessions, you get the term there, Tenava, which talks about that.
Tenava, very important group. We'll talk about them maybe, because, you know, Jimmy Rogers was a member of the Tenava Ramblers. Mm-hmm. But we'll come back to that. I've jumped ahead of myself. So these sessions took place on the Tennessee side.
Okay.
When a man called Ralph Peer from Victor Records set up a studio in a sort of temporarily disused shop, I think it was a milliner's shop. Now, when I say set up, he hung up carpets to sort of confine the sound, and he had very basic recording equipment. The early days, Victor Records, I think it was like wax donut things, and then, you know, they recorded, and then they turned out old RPMs, 78 RPMs, and he set up there, put an ad in the paper. He had been all through Georgia and Alabama, and he put up an ad saying, "Any local musicians, I'm setting up this session." You know, it was like, you know, America, you know, Clinch Mountain's Got Talent or something, like that kind of thing. And people came from all around then to record. And two very important acts, and I mentioned then just because of a family connection, one less or so. But the two big acts that we want to talk about that he recorded there were Jimmy Rogers, the singing brakeman, and the Carter family. And the Carter family, very significant also. You know about the Carter family. We'll talk about their Ulster connection first of all. Mm-hmm. The Carter family lived at a place called Mesa Spring in what was called the Poor Valley of Clinch Mountain. They were hard scrabble, you know, poor people, really. The members of the band were a guy called A.P. Carter, stands for Alvin Pleasant Carter. And he was married to a girl called Sarah, who was Dougherty to her maiden name. Mm-hmm. And her grandfather came from County Tyrone.
Right, okay.
And her cousin, who shared the same grandfather, was Maybelle Eddington. Mm-hmm. And for good measure, in the best traditions of, you know, the Clinch Mountains, she was also married to AP's brother, Ezra, who's sometimes called Eck. Eck seems to be nice. And they had a little band that they played in, and the girls were, you know, they'd taught themselves. Sarah was a very good guitarist. Maybell played guitar. She also played the auto harp. They produced a sound based on, like, folk songs of the British Isles, you know, as they had developed. Sarah was only 16 years of age when they married, and long-term, I mean, the marriage didn't last. But they made their way to Ralph Peer's audition in an old Model A Ford that they borrowed. Now, although they lived, Mesa Springs, not that far from Bristol, it was quite a journey. It took them all day. They had to cross a river with the car. Yeah. They got four punctures, and it was blazing heat. So it wasn't an easy journey, but it was worthwhile because Peer was most impressed. They sang the old song. Alvin had collected songs, and then because nobody else had really copyrighted them, he was able to copyright a lot of them. Mm-hmm. But the song was quite an old song called Bury Me Under the Weeping Willow. And it's a standard to this day. It's had a huge impact. People are still recording it. It still stands up as a, you know, an excellent song, and was at the very core of country music in a sense, that those guitar licks and the words of that old song.
Okay, well, give me 1 second and I'll play. I think I can play a clip of it.
Him in heaven above.
That's a clip from it.
Yeah, you see the three of them there, and then you see Maybell's daughters, one of whom, June, later married Johnny Cash.
Yeah, June Carter Cash.
June Carter Cash, and they became like country music royalty, that's what you would say, in a way. But they're a very significant family, and that carried through to the present day. You can still go to the Carter Fold in Bristol, and you know, there's a country music show at least once a week there. They've also now built a museum. In 2014, they opened a museum to this event in Bristol. And it's worth a visit if you're in that area. You're talking about down in the southwest of Virginia, touches on Tennessee, obviously, and North Carolina and Kentucky, and indeed West Virginia are all, you know, within a bagel's gowl, as we say, in that little corner. That was where they drew from. And their music drew on, as I say, the old folk songs. They didn't last that long, the marriage between Alvin and Sarah. Sarah went out to California, I think, to live eventually. And I think she died in the 1960s. But that's the Carter family.
But it's interesting when you sort of look to the Bristol Sessions and that sort of impact that they had on country music, you know, for years to come, and sort of recording in general. How many the groups who turned up, you know, the staples that were being played by them were things like those ballads that had probably crossed, you know, the Atlantic Ocean from these islands. Plus the sort of things you wouldn't be surprised if you were at a revival meeting today, the old hymns and gospel sort of songs.
What I say of all of this. It's a bit like what we're saying about the poetry. These things were so easily carried. Mm-hmm. You know, you didn't have to worry about, you know, dust or anything. They were carried in people's heads and here, and they became part of what Jung called, I suppose, the collective unconscious. They became what were part of the culture. The other big performer on that occasion, as you know, was Jimmy Rogers, who came from a Scots-Irish family, but had and he was born in Meridian, Mississippi, in I think 1897, and his father worked on the railway as an engineer. But the big Scotch, they were a Scotch-Irish family, although Jimmy Rogers had other lines. He had German lines, he had English lines. That's the important thing people forget nowadays. They think, oh, the Scotch-Irish in America, where do they live now? But, you know, Americans have German lines, they have English lines, they have Scott, a lot of them have Scotch-Irish lines, because we were there very, very early.
Mm-hmm.
And for some reason, maybe it is culture, their Scotch-Irish lines resonate very strongly with a lot of them.
Mm-hmm.
John Steinbeck, the novelist, you know, his father was Gross Steinbeck, German. But he was fascinated by the Hamiltons, his mother's people,
yeah.
who came from outside Lima Valley.
He actually came back in the late...
Oh, yeah, he did. He visited twice.
To try and find relatives.
That's right. He didn't actually find them, but, I mean, I know where they are. I don't want to get into John Steinbeck, but the point, you know, about that is that he said, when he was asked about that, well, I suppose they said the Ulster blood in my veins must have run thicker than the German.
Mm.
And whatever that means, but I think it means the culture runs stronger.
Yeah.
And a big part of it, you know, is literature, yes, but it's also the music.
Yeah.
Jimmy Rogers' influences were huge in Mississippi. He wasn't doing that well at school. And when he's about in his early teens, his father said, right, yeah, continue school and make something of it, or get yourself a job on the railroad here. The father worked for the Ohio and Mobile Railroad. So Jimmy began at age 14 as a water carrier.
Mm-hmm.
A bit like Rudyard Kipling or something, the water carrier. But he carried water to black guys who were working on the railroads in that area. And he got to know them, got to know their music, and got to know some of their songs. And that was a huge influence on the young boy as a 14-year-old. And it's an interesting scenario because the black workers were, you know, probably the sons or grandsons of slaves, but they were now actually working, and Jimmy Rogers carried water to them.
Yeah.
So it was an interesting social mixture, but meant that he had no compunction about adopting black culture. He married his second wife when he was age 23. I mean, they did things early, and her name was Carrie Williamson, and she was still kind of in college, I think you would say, very young. Her father was a Methodist minister, and she had been taught music, knew how to read music, and, you know, was a big influence, brought a lot of songs with her from that tradition into the family. Her sister, Elsie, who was married to a policeman in Meridian, Dick McWilliams, so she was Elsie McWilliams, she not only wrote the music, she could write songs, and she wrote a lot of Jimmy Rogers songs for him. Mm-hmm. Although the two of them are credited on the songs, Elsie was a big influence because, I say, she could read music, knew how to scan it, knew how to set it down. Mm-hmm. And she also performed with Jimmy Rogers on occasions. Jimmy Rogers was in a lot of bands. Mm-hmm. I mean, he didn't come up that day from Meridian, Mississippi. You know, he'd been all over the southern states performing. He'd performed as blackface in a minstrel show. He drew on all kinds of musical influences, Hawaiian, English, but particularly on the blues of the Delta of Mississippi. And jazz, he once sang in front of a band that had Louis Armstrong in the background. So his influences were many. And where the Carters were kind of rustic people, mountain people dressed very, you know, plainly, and say a borrowed Model A Ford car, Rogers was kind of very much Tin Pan Alley. If you ever see photographs of him, there is sometimes he's wearing, they made him wear sort of brakeman's outfit of a wee cap and like black dungarees and stuff. Uh-huh. He hated wearing that. And sometimes you like to see him wearing that with a dicky bow and a dress shirt below it, because he favoured the show business look very much. And was at this sort of the other extreme from the Carters in that way. The thing about him also was that he had TB and was very ill. And I mean, he died in 1933. He was only 36. There is I read somewhere one time, 1932, I think it was, he went to New York, to New Jersey, to Canton, New Jersey, to record with another Scotch-Irish fiddler called Clayton McMichan. And McMichan had to administer morphine shots to him in the middle, you know, virtually in the middle of the recording. Very, very ill. But had a huge impact in those years because he followed up on the Bristol session. At the Bristol session, he wanted to sing a railroad song, but Ralph Peer didn't want it. Ralph wanted the sort of more sentimental, softer songs that Roger sang, probably that Elsie wrote. So he sang The Soldier's Sweetheart and Sleep Baby Sleep on the first occasion. And then he followed up with Peer and got a relationship going. And after Bristol, he would have gone up and recorded in New York with Ralph Peer at studios there. Between 1927, here when he's discovered, and 1933 when he died, he sold 12 million records, which was huge. Mm. I mean, it's huge today, but huge then. Mm. He just became the voice of, I suppose, the Scotch-Irish people living in the South.
Yeah.
People would get to the country store, they'd get eggs, they'd get coffee, they'd get cornmeal, whatever they were buying, and they'd say, oh, the latest record by Jimmy Rogers, big old 78 RPM that would break, you know, and cost 75 cents, which was quite big money.
Yeah.
And it's quite big money when you multiply it by 12 million.
Yeah.
So Rogers became very wealthy in a short space of time and built himself a big home in Texas, actually.
Yeah.
But
I think money, I read he built a house somewhere in a town that had a TB sanatorium. So that he, you know, with the hope that...
Is that right? I didn't know that. That would figure, though, that he could go there.
Yeah.
But one of his most famous songs was Tea for Texas.
Yeah.
And he eventually sang it. He wanted to sing it too at the Bristol Sessions. But again, as I say, Peer just wanted that initial audition, just these kind of soft, sentimental songs. So he had a big influence on a lot of people. I mean, in country music, people like Merle Haggard, Hank Snow, Lefty Frizzell, all had a big draw on the songs of Jimmy Rogers. And in recent times, actually, there's an album I have called Songs of Jimmy Rogers where other people perform his songs.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, Bono for U2, Van Morrison, Bob Dylan, and there's a wonderful version of Peach Picking Town down in Georgia, Jimmy Rogers' song by Willie Nelson on that album. It's very worth getting that album if anybody's interested. But that's the kind of influence that came right through. And I think it was because Rogers drew on so many influences.
Mm-hmm.
In a sense, they were all the influences of America.
And he was able to sort of give voice to them in some ways and in his own way.
He was able to fuse them or draw them together. He had a voice that was kind of sly and laconic. Kind of was the voice of America. You know, it's not a powerful singing voice, but there's, you can see people like Woody Guthrie and Bob Dylan affecting that voice later on too, that kind of, almost not a snarl, but a nasal kind of laconic out of the side of the mouth.
I'll play a wee clip here of, I'll play a wee clip here from Waiting for a Train.
All around the water tanks, waiting for a train, a thousand miles away from home, sleeping in the rain. I walked up to a brakeman to give him a line of talk. He says, if you've got money, I'll see that you don't walk.
That's a wee clip of one of his two.
Yeah, and it just occurs to me listening to it there. You know, here you have social commentary coming into a popular form of singing because he's saying, you know, the guy is poor, he's no money, but the railroad guy says, get off your bum, and he has no time for him. And Roger's songs that are about the railroad are drawn on what he saw, which was, you know, the hobos, the guys who wrote the reels because they had nowhere else to live. It's the down and outs that he writes about in many of his songs. And that's one of them, in a sense, that picks out that social commentary that's kind of saying, hey, things are not all, maybe that they're cracked up to be. Everything isn't beautiful, you know. That people hooked into two. Rogers seemed to be speaking for them. It's kind of a voice of every man. So he's the first person to be inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame.
Right. Right, okay.
So he, in a way, is seen by many. He's certainly one of the daddies of them all. The personal one I was going to mention was a man called Charlie McReynolds and his Bull Mountain Moonshiners, who are the same McReynolds as our family. And he went along to the session, and he had a bunch of Scotch-Irish stalwarts with him. A man called Howard Green, Charlie Greer, another guy called Bill Dean, and sometimes Charlie's daughter Maggie played with them as well. Fiddle players. Charlie was playing a fiddle he'd made himself. When I say made himself, I think it was a kind of like an Irfix, early Irfix kit type thing that he glued together, you know. Actually, old Jesse McReynolds used it when they had, in 2014, it's on that record, Orthophonic Joy, to play, because he was his grandson. And in the 1960s, Jim and Jesse McReynolds drew on that tradition and had a stack of hits, members of the Grand Ole Opry. Jesse's still about. He's in his 90s. And occasionally, if you're looking through YouTube or something, you'll see he's, you know, sat in on an album with some of the modern-day singers that are involved that still bring him along to play, because he invented a mandolin style that was to cross-pick the mandolin like a banjo. Mm-hmm. And he's played on all kinds of records, even sessions. He played on the Grateful Dead's albums as a mandolin player. So Rhonda Vincent had him on a recent album that she released. And as I say, he was 90 plus when he performed it. But his grandfather was old Charlie. And that name, the Moon Shiners, they made that name up in the car on the way over to the audition, because they say, what are we going to call ourselves, you know? Mm-hmm. So I thought I would just mention that as well.
It's interesting, the Orthophonic Joy album, where they talk about a lot of the, you know, modern reinterpretations of the Bristol sessions, they talk about that, and they had McReynolds playing the fiddle.
Aye.
Grandfather had played in
with Carl Jackson.
Sessions.
Yeah, Carl Jackson put that whole album together. He's made a wonderful contribution. I should just say, Jimmy Rogers, I think, wasn't always an easy person, jumping back to Jimmy Rogers, to get along with. On the way over to the auditions, he was living at that time in Asheville, North Carolina, not too far away. And he was traveling with his band, the Tenifer Ramblers, but they fell out on the way. And the Tenifer Ramblers, who were on the album, the Orphonic Joy album as well, they said to him, no, you go to appear on your own. We want nothing to do with you. So that was how Jimmy Rogers actually appeared in those editions on his own. It was a result of a kind of a fallout.
Yeah. You wouldn't find that normally with Scots-Irish people. They would never really
know. It's something that has crept in. It must be part of his German or his English heritage or something, because we're not known for being difficult. But that's... That's the two main guys, or the two main acts, I suppose, in the Bristol sessions. It's worth going to Bristol. I keep saying Bristol, Virginia, because that's the way I think of it, but technically it was Bristol, Tennessee. I should say there was good cooperation. There's no problem about that. When they built that museum, although it was built in Tennessee, Virginia, as a state, paid a lot of the money towards it. Mm-hmm. It's a big tourist attraction. A lot of people go because they're interested in that. Americans themselves are interested when I say tourist. I suppose the other guy, if we're talking outside of Bristol, have you anything else you want to ask me
about Bristol? I think it's important to sort of look at, you know, Bristol, here we have what's called the Big Bang. So you suddenly, this is like where country music takes off. But I think for what we were talking about was the idea of, you know, here, what are the roots beyond that where that go into country music, you know? And I think it's important to sort of look at that and see.
Well, I think you ask the average layman, he'll say, well, Hank Williams was, you know, tremendously important. And he was. And I have seen people say Hank Williams' ancestry was Scotch-Irish, but I've never seen it sufficiently that it convinced me. Mm-hmm. But he was important. But a couple of other people who had Scotch-Irish ancestry were also important, and maybe not, well, one of them in particular not heard of so much. The one I'm thinking about, you know, if you ask who invented bluegrass music, a lot of people say, oh, Bill Monroe. Mm-hmm. That is true to some extent. He didn't invent it. He kind of crystallized it, is one way I'd put it. Again, he's a guy who had to sort of grow up fast. You know, he's orphaned at 14 and farmed about from one relative to another. And but a big influence on him is his uncle, you know, the song Uncle Penn that he had. His uncle Pendleton Van Diver. Now, that's Van Diver, not Van Driver. It's, it's a Dutch name, obviously.
Uh-huh.
But the Van Diver is Dutch, but Van Diver's mother was Scotch-Irish, and her name was Forrest, which I understand is a version of the name Fergus. Their ancestors had come from the Hebrides to County Antrim, and from County Antrim they'd gone to New Jersey, to Burlington, New Jersey, from there to Tennessee, and then a short hop to Kentucky. And he's born in Rossine, Kentucky, R-O-S-I-N-E, in 1911. So at the time of the Bristol Sessions, Bill Monroe had only been 16.
Yeah.
The influence of Van Diver, the Forest has brought with him a lot of Scotch-Irish songs.
Mm-hmm.
But the other thing was that Van Diver, his Uncle Penn, also was friendly with a guy who worked with him and appeared in little country bands with him, a man called Arnold Schultz, who was black, he was the son of a slave.
Mm-hmm.
And he taught Van Diver how to play guitar, banjo, and then he had passed it on to Bill. So again, you have this African influence coming through and mixing with the Scotch-Irish to produce bluegrass. And what a lot of people don't know, I think, is because I heard a guy, and I had to correct him on a live radio show, saying, you know, the Scotch-Irish brought their banjos with them. Banjo is an African instrument.
Yeah.
Banjos were played on the plantations because Thomas Jefferson talks about them playing there. So the African influence mixed with the Scotch-Irish is what has produced this particular commodity, if you want to call it that, of bluegrass. And Bill Monroe dripped up, you know, picked up all those influences. He began playing very early in his teens, him and his brother Charlie. Sometimes Arnold Schultz was on the stage with them, which was pretty brave in you know, the 1930s.
Those times, yeah.
Remembering all of this, too, if you're talking about, certainly, you know, the 1930s, you're talking about the Depression.
Yeah.
So people are buying these records in the middle of the Depression, whether it's escapism or what it is, I'm not sure. But they started to play. And then, as you talk about difficult, Bill Monroe, I think, was a difficult person to work with. People who were in and out of his band, like Yo-Yos, said that if there was a lull, if there weren't many gigs or that sort of thing, he made them do farm work. So among the people who came through his band, if you like, two very important guys, Lester Flatts and Earl Scruggs.
Mm-hmm.
Earl Scruggs' banjo playing revolutionized bluegrass and country music. Different style, bending the notes, playing with the keys as he's playing with them. A lot of people would have come across their music first, I suppose, in the old Beverly Hillbillies TV program.
Mm-hmm.
They played the ballad of Jed Clampett, Scruggs, and Lester Flatt. And Lester Flatt, Scotch-Irish, his family came from the Orkneys or somewhere. It's an unusual name. I'm not sure about it.
They also play a role then in another sort of seminal bluegrass country music album, you know, Will the Circle Be Unbroken? Late 70s or something?
I think that's right, yes.
And even on that, for example, they have Maybelle Carter.
Yes, they realized, you know, they were able to pull it in and recycle. Willie Guthrie sang a lot of, you know, Carter family songs, recycled them as well. You get this sort of recycling thing. That's a very important point, actually. But Bill Monroe, Del McCorry, for instance, sang on Bill Monroe's Bluegrass Boys. A young Ricky Skaggs would have played with him as well. So the people in and out of his band, it was almost like a college. People went to learn how to do bluegrass and move on. And then people played with Lester Flatts and Earl Scruggs, so
I moved on. A wee piece here, a Bill Monroe track. Blue Moon of Kentucky. And it's funny there, you know, the image is Bill Monroe and his Bluegrass Boy.
Yeah, that voice, that high, lonesome sound, as they talk about, is sort of indicative of country music. In fact, when Bill Monroe was asked one time to say, well, what is bluegrass? You know, he said, it's got a hard drive to it. It's Scotch bagpipes and old-time fiddling. It's Methodist and holiness and Baptist. It's blues and jazz, and it has a high, lonesome sound. It's playing music that tells a story. It's played from my heart to your heart, and it will touch you. And that's pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah.
And he's a big force even today. Rhonda Vincent has a recent song out, a sort of a tribute to him, addressed to him in heaven, called "Is the grass any bluer on the other side?" And you know, it's about Bill Monroe. It's a sort of a addressed to him. You get that in country music a lot. You get sort of tribute songs to former country musicians. For instance, talked about Carrie Williamson there. She mentored then Ernest Tubb, you know, the country singer of the 60s, I suppose. And he wrote a lot of songs about Jimmy Rogers.
Yeah.
So you get that sort of recycling thing, sort of a mention in a different way. There, but the Van Diver influence, the mother being Scotch Irish, Monroe sought to combine the two, I suppose, in Uncle Penn's memory. Uncle Penn, the song is an interesting song because it describes how the uncle lived in a hill up above in Racine, Kentucky, and when he started to play in the evening, everybody could hear his music. It just came down into the hollow, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The Monroes, I think, were Scots directly. They may have been related to President Monroe. But the name is interesting just as a tenuous connection in that the name actually means people who live by the River Road.
Nice.
Which it must be one of those names that derived here and then went to Scotland, came back.
Mm-hmm.
Or in his case, went straight to America. Because I think President Monroe was of direct Scots. I don't know why we claim him in those 18 that you mentioned, Bernard. I can't be sure, but I think he was a Highland Scot, really.
Mm.
Yeah, but that influence in Bill Monroe of his father, the Farris name, which means Fergus. And, you know, we still have names like Ferris and Farry, the MP. That's all basically, those are basically the same names.
Mm.
One version or another of them. And okay. It's the same with the next name of the very last guy I was going to mention, and that was... Sorry, is there anything else you want to ask me about Bill Monroe?
No, work away, move on. You were going to talk to us about a guy with an interesting name, Moon Mulligan.
Yeah, well, Moon's not his actual name. Aubrey Wilson Moon Mulligan was his name. And he's sometimes called the King of the Hillbilly Piano Players. Born March 29th, 1909, into a Scotch-Irish in Polk County, Texas. Of course, Polk, named after President Polk, who was Scots-Irish. Is that name Pollock, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Born into a deeply religious family. And the name Mulligan is a version of the name Milliken, which, you know, derived in Donegal.
Mm-hmm.
And again, then went to Scotland. There are various versions of it. Milligan, Mulligan, and in this case, Mulligan was a name that came back into Ulster. And Sir William Petty reckons the Mulligans were centred around South Antrim, or that's where I'm sitting talking to you.
Mm-hmm.
Family, very religious family. as I say, they moved first to to Maryland and then down into to the Polk County, Texas, which is on the border with Louisiana, which is significant in a way. Oscar was the father's name, and they lived in a farm. But the farm was nearby a forest, you know, with lumberjacks, and there was a rambunctious musical tradition, shall we say, in the area. So the father spent $20 when Aubrey was very young and bought a pump-action organ that he intended Aubrey to learn and play at church.
Right, okay.
But Aubrey had other ideas. And so you find 14-year-old Aubrey playing piano in a cafe in Lufkin, Texas, and getting loads of tips because he was playing this honky-tonk style of piano. He said he wasn't playing it right if the beer bottles didn't dance on the actual piano. And as a 14-year-old, he's walking away with $40 in tips.
Right, okay.
Which is 1923. Big money, you know. So at 16, he headed for Houston and there started to play in dances. And he earned the nickname Moon. I don't know how. But his influences, here's the list of influences when he was asked to quote who influenced him. He said Bessie Smith, Blind Lemon Jefferson, Leroy Carr, and in the country idiom, Jimmy Rogers and Bob Wills. Mm-hmm. Bob Wills is Texas Playboys. But there are those other influences, Bessie Smith, Blind Lemon Jefferson, Leroy Carr. I think if you ask Van Morrison whose influences are, he lists those three. And they're black musicians, they're blues musicians. So again, Aubrey is much influenced by that. Mm-hmm. But he was very friendly and a contemporary of people like Jim Reeves, but also Hank Williams.
Mm-hmm.
The story goes that one of Hank Williams' biggest hits is a song called Jambalaya. And it's written for, it's a Cajun song, written in sort of half Cajun French, if you know it.
Yeah.
Goodbye, Joe, I gotta, you know, all that.
Yeah.
But Aubrey actually wrote it.
Right, okay.
He couldn't claim it because it's some kind of contract. I don't know the ins and outs, but it was a contract with the recording label. I think they were King Records or something like that. And so he couldn't record it. But all his life, he drew 50% of the royalties.
Right, okay.
And he then wrote a sort of an answer, the song, Yvonne singing her half of the song, if you know it.
Uh-huh.
And he claimed that completely on his own. But, you know, the deed was done. It was kind of, people thought it was imitative. And he didn't get the same kind of royalties.
Mm-hmm.
Moon influenced a lot of people. Bill Haley, Elvis,
mm-hmm.
who was known as the Hillbilly Cat. And incidentally, you played earlier there, Blue Moon of Kentucky, one of Elvis's first recordings, Blue Moon of Kentucky,
mm-hmm.
Jazz, you know, sung Elvis style, beating his guitar box and, mm-hmm. you know, swiveling those hips. And the other person, Corrigan, as you maybe know, the other person who came at the same time, Jerry Lee Lewis,
yeah,
and his piano playing. And, you know, I always think Jerry Lee Lewis is reckoned this great rock and roll star. But I always thought his country music singing was better.
Yeah.
Although maybe it wasn't as lucrative, I don't know. But certainly Hank was, Williams was asked one time who was his favorite performer. And he said, yeah, Moon Mulligan.
Yeah.
One of his songs, and it was written on his grave. He had the inscription on his grave, I'll sail my ship alone.
Yeah.
Have you got a clip of that?
I'm just thinking, you know, if we do a quick recap there, you know, we're talking through here's like,
yep.
you know, from very early days, you have sort of Scotch-Irish influences melding with other sort of
yep.
musical styles within America, taking it, you know, all those different streams together, pushing them through, feeding into what becomes country music. And then, you know, as the years progress, here we are, we've come up through Bill Monroe and all his stuff. We're into Moon Mulligan.
And rock and roll.
And from Moon Mulligan, then you jump into, you know, your sort of rock and roll, Jerry Lee Lewis, Elvis Presley.
Yep, yep.
And the influences continue.
Well, it's very good, David, that summary, because there you have, like, Western culture. What a contribution to it.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, who influenced the Beatles and the Everly Brothers and all these other people outside the country idiom, not to mention that alone. And country music's big in Northern Ireland, but it is huge in America.
Yeah.
You know, really.
Huge. I don't think we realize here how big it is. I'll play this quick clip.
With Moon, you're getting into jukeboxes and, you know, the king of the hillbilly piano players and the development of rockabilly.
So we'll play this wee clip.
Okay.
I'll sail my ship alone with all the dreams I own. Drifting out across the ocean blue. I'll sail my ship alone, though all the sails you've torn. And when it starts to sink, then I'll blame you.
It's a good clip because you can almost hear all the influences.
Yeah, but that's a good line, isn't it? And when it starts to sink, I blame you.
Listen, well, Moon wasn't without a sense of humour, and you'll find that in a lot of his songs.
Yeah.
That, you know, he taps onto real life, but he taps onto humour. But he died in 1967. Uh-huh. I think he actually died on stage. He's buried in Texas. But I Sail My Ship Alone was one, but I suppose the other big one would be Jambalaya, which many people
Know for, be aware
for of. Hank Williams and his trip from Cowboys.
Okay. Listen, thanks very much. I'm going to stop the recording now, but that's been really interesting, and we'll pick this up again and build on it for the
future. To be continued.
To be continued.